You are in for a treat. I think you're supposed to say that at the beginning of the sermon every time, just not about yourself. Anyway, I'm glad that you're here. But we're going to do a little bit different this morning. We're going to talk to you. And my wife and I are both going to talk to you this morning because I believe that the Lord is doing something, and he's doing something in families, by the way. He's doing something in marriages, and that is a really important aspect of our walk because we are whole people, and God speaks to every area of our life. And moving forward, in our family, one of those things has been the Lord just has been using my wife and myself back and forth and kind of fleshing out ideas. You know, I think it's interesting in the New Testament, Paul makes mention of, you know, we see, but as in a mirror dimly, right? We see and we think we know, but we know only in part, right? You and I were made to be the body. We weren't made for one person to do everything and everybody comes and attends, right? We were made to affect each other. We were made to be together. We were made to love each other. We were made to be fashioned and shaped and molded and sharpened with each other. We were made probably to irritate each other a little bit so that we can come out the other side better than we were going in, right? This is a team game. And part of that, I just felt like, you know what? I really wanted Jennifer to share, by the way, some things that were on her heart, and then I will close. Okay, we'll do it that way. But in any case, this is my lovely wife, Jennifer. I know, I just like to say that because as if, anyone here from Lake Oswego? No? No? Okay. Gary? At some level, you're the closest. He worked there. All right.
Funny thing is that when he asked me, we knew he was going to be teaching today, or what are you preaching, or whatever you want to call it, speaking today. And then the other day, okay, this isn't working for me. The other day, I was having a meltdown, and that happens. You know, that happens. I'm a mom. I have four kids. It happens a lot, really. And so we've been having, I decided, well, okay, I prayed about this a lot, and we prayed about this a lot. Really, we decided to homeschool this year, two of them, the older two. And it's been, I was expecting it to be tough. I was ready for that. So the first couple of weeks, I was like, yeah, this is tough, but I expected that. It's okay, we can do this. We're about 4 or 5 weeks in now, and I'm like, I woke up with this picture this morning, and I think this is how I feel. Jude plays soccer, and when they train, they're training on regular grass. But when they play games, they play on turf. And what I've learned, because I know nothing about soccer, what I have learned is that when they get onto the turf, that ball goes and it doesn't stop. So they have to, I mean, not literally, like it will eventually stop, but like they kick it, they can't kick it with the same force that they kick it on the regular grass. So you see them sometimes not ready for that because it's tough when you really play how you train. And so they'll get it way out in front of them and they're running with everything they have. And they realize it's too far out there. And they have to turn on the jets and it's just, they're giving it all they have. And that's how I feel right now. We are having car issues that are not ending. We were just saying too, not too long ago, we've been through so many trials, which are training ground. The Lord uses those. That's all important. If you came to Christ thinking this was going to be easier, you now know that's not the truth. So we were like, we've never had really car issues. We've had these great cars, and God has been faithful, in that we chose cars. You never know when you're buying a car, you know, and you get, oh, these cars worked a long time. Well, and we've had them a long time now, and now we're paying the price. It's just one thing after another. My car's been in the shop for a week, and it was before that. It was a couple days, and then a couple days again. It was just like, oh, as I'm trying to homeschool, okay, you get it. You've been to that kind. You've experienced that. So I'm got the ball way out there, and I'm just going with all I have. And I'm like, I persevere. I'm a fighter. I love the war. I love the battle. Like, I can fight. I've got that passion for me, but or passion in me. That's a gift. Everybody's got their own, their gifts the Lord has put in them, and we all help each other. And that's the thing that I can do. I can encourage you. We're going to fight. We're going to win. We're not going to give up. But all right now, I am just, wow, that ball's far out there. In over my head, I feel like. But so all week long, I'm just exhausting myself. And then we get a moment. He's working overtime a lot so that we can pay for this. And we get a moment, and we just got to unload. We're unloading, and I'm unloading. And I'm trying really hard not to complain, too. That's another thing. At the same time, I'm trying not to be a complainer when I'm really a complainer. And I'm just unloading, and I sound ugly. You know, the ugliness is coming out, you know? And he goes, you want to share with me on Sunday? And I just start bawling. Because I'm like, that is a desire in my heart, has been. It's one of those secret things, like, Lord, I'd love this. I'd love to do that. I'd love if that was a thing you made me for. I just would love that. And then it was like, here it is, and you're not ready for it. And I'm like, yeah, that's true. I'm not ready for that. So today I don't feel that teaching is really a gift of mine, but I know there is that thing. I don't know if it's that fighter in me, but I have that passion. So I'm going to kind of just throw some stuff out that's on my heart. And we'll see how this situation works for me, because I've got two books. So I hope that at the end of that I convey a couple things. One is God's incredible love for us. And the other one is to find that in the secret place. And so I want to start with this scripture. So, okay, back in the old days, when Israel just, you know, they just got their land, and they're like, wow, this is really cool. And they've had judges. They even had a king. Other nations have kings. And they're like, they start going, well, we want a king. That we want to be like them. And they're grumbling, and they're just poor Samuel. And he was great, and they were just sometimes not very kind. They're just complaining, we don't like the way you're doing this, and we want something else. Tell God this for us. And so God says, okay, but warn them. It's not all that great to have a king. But I'll give you a king. You can have a king. So they get Saul, and Saul, they're just impressed. He's taller than everybody else, good looking. He's got it all together. They just, yeah, he comes from the right tribe. They're like, Saul's the best. And Saul generally honors God, you know, in the beginning. And then things start to change, and he really likes his position, and he starts to dishonor God. And so all along, though, God has been... he's been raising up. He has a better idea. Okay, you want a king? I'll give you a king, but I have a better idea. So he tells Samuel, go. I'm going to tell you where to go. I'm going to tell you where this guy is, and you're going to anoint him. And hang on, because I think I accidentally marked the wrong place. It happens, you know. I got laundry everywhere, and okay. So all the okay. So Samuel goes to David's house. You know who I'm talking about. This is David. Samuel goes to David's house, and David's dad brings in all his sons, and he's so proud. He lines them all. These are the names of the children born to him. Let's see, this is right. No, that's not right. I thought it was already. 1 Samuel 9. That might be my problem. When Samuel comes to David's house. First. Okay. Okay, got it. Okay. No. See, the Samuel, those two books are really kind of confusing. They don't go chronologically. Okay, then I'm just going to go from memory, which is really not my favorite. I mean, I don't mind that, but I wanted to, there was parts in there I wanted to read. But so David takes care of his father's sheep. He's a shepherd. And I think he's the youngest. He's the youngest son. So when Samuel comes to David's father's house and says, I want to see your sons, he lines them all up. I don't remember how many there were, but they all were good. They looked good. And dad was real proud of them. And Samuel says, no, is this it? No, this isn't it. How does Samuel know that? How does Samuel know that? He knows that he has not been presented with all of the sons. And so, okay, there's one more, right? Does he present it? Does he bring him out? Aww. Yeah, is this all your sons? And anyways, so David isn't the one, he isn't the one that even his dad's proud of, you know? Even his dad's not all that impressed with him. But David is the one that's been out in the secret place for forever. He's out with the sheep, he's with the Lord, he's cultivating that intimate relationship with the Lord, and that's the one the Lord wants. And Saul is the one that looks good, and all these others look good, and they're impressive in the eyes of man, but that's not what the Lord's after. I love that story that, you know, God loves, he does not value what man values. And I just think that's incredible. So one more thing. I wanted to share this what really stood out to me to convey God's heart was that classic story of the prodigal son. So there was a man who had, and this is Luke 15:11. There was a man who had two sons. The younger one said to his father, Father, give me my share of the estate. So he divided his property between them. And in their culture, this was like saying, I wish you were dead, Dad. I want out of here. I can't, you know. Oh, that's nice. Not long after that, the younger son got together all he had, set off for a distant country, and there squandered his wealth in wild living after he had spent everything. There was a severe famine in that whole country, and he began to be in need. So he went and hired himself out to a citizen of that country who sent him to his fields to feed pigs. So he got a real crappy job. And he longed to fill his stomach with the pods that the pigs were eating. He wanted the food the pigs were eating. He's starving. But no one gave him anything. When he came to his senses, he said, how many of my father's hired men have food to spare? And here I am starving to death. I will set out and go back to my father and say to him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and against you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son. Make me like one of your hired men. So he got up and went to his father. But while he was still a long way off, his father saw him and was filled with compassion for him. He ran to his son, threw his arms around him, and kissed him. So what love is so is like, it's love is offendable. It's so, it's offensive, kind of, in a way. Let me tell you how. That doesn't make sense. If your son did that to you, and you'd be justified to say, sorry, no, don't come back here. You've dishonored me. You have I'm disrespected, and you didn't value what I've built. You took what I built, and you ran off with it, and you lost it, and you just destroyed your own life and took half of, you know, what I had. And now you're coming back. But the Father, and this is the heart of God toward us, the Father gets up, which they say was, you don't do this when you're like a ruler of land. You're not, you know, it's not respectable behavior to get up and run because you got a robe on and he, you know, you just don't do that. He gets up and he runs to his son. That's amazing how, and this is how Jesus is telling us the heart of God toward us. This is the heart of God toward us. It's not a list. He doesn't have a list of behavior. Okay, I'll take you back, but you're going to have to do this and this and this. You're going to have to act right. And I still try to do that. And that, I think, is one of the things that just exhausts me. Is that I'm still trying to just, okay, I got to hold it together. I got to look good. I got to make my kids act right. I got to, and I get mad and I get just overwhelmed. And God says to me this week as I'm overwhelmed, like they're not acting right and I'm not acting right. And you know, I'm just, the wheels are falling off. I'm a hot mess. And God says to me, he says to me, I'm waiting for you in the secret place. I know you need help. And I have the keys for you there. I have the keys to help you. I don't want you to suffer. And I know it's hard. And I don't just take the suffering away, but I give you the keys. I give you the word that you need to keep going. I give you the word you need to reassure you and to set your heart right and to make your perspective right. The perspective is, this is all about love. And you're not earning anything. And when he comes inside of us and he changes us from the inside out, then we start looking like him. And we're not just acting like him, we're really being like him. And that's what he wants. He doesn't want us to act right. He doesn't want us to work harder. That is the thing. I just, that's not going right. I'm going to work harder. And I do that. And I know there's a gift there in that work. I work hard, but most of the time I'm trying to earn it, really. I'm trying to earn something. I'm trying to, and it's not what the Lord has for us. There's so much more peace. There's so much more rest. There's so much more love. And kids, one more thing. I want to talk about my kids because that has been very challenging. I mean, it's just always been challenging, but I want, for a long time when they're little, you know, you teach them to act right. And that's not bad. That, you know, it's for safety. You know, you train them. I trained them to sit because we were in church a lot, so they had to sit for a long time. And, you know, there's just a lot of training that I think's also important for safety. Like if I say, stop, don't run for that road, they stop. But now we're getting to Jude and Jack are getting to the age where they have developed their own, like, personalities, and they have their own desires, and homeschooling both of them is becoming very clear that what's working for him is not working for him, and the Lord, I'm just like, oh God, I really wanted them to I really want this to go right. I really want this to go well. I really am just, I'm working hard to make it look good, you know, make it work. And God he just is telling me, love is my weapon in this time when they aren't acting right. I have, because that's the thing that is really really at stake, is the love right there. And that's the most important thing. So I'm going, okay, they're not robots anymore. And yeah, they're not robots. And I got to get, the most important thing is I got to get to their heart. And if I get to their heart with love, with his love, real love, it's radical. And when you feel the love of God, and I've had times when he's let me feel the love of God for someone else, and his love for someone else, and I know he says, this is only a piece of it. And I feel like you got to stop because I can't handle it. It's overwhelming. It's incredible, his love for us. Just, and any, everybody, like the ugliest, the most, the biggest failures, like, or what, you know, in our eyes, their biggest failures. And God's love is like, oh man, you don't know what they've been through. You don't know what they're battling. Love them. I want you to love. So I pray. So I'm going to pray. This is my prayer. Jesus, I desperately need your heart for the world, for your people, for your children, for my children, for everybody you put in front of me. I want you to radically transform my heart. And I pray that for us here today, Lord, that you would come and radically transform our hearts, that they're like yours, that we can love, we won't be offended. People can't offend us because there's so much love flowing through us. And Lord, that you help us to not try to achieve this. We're having it. This is it. You've given it to us. Help us find that secret place where it's just you and me. It's just the two of us. And we hear your heart and we know your love. And you teach us. The word says that no longer shall man have to learn from, and this is Hebrews 8, no longer will man have to learn from someone else. Come and know the Lord. It's between you and me. You teach me. So Lord, teach us. Help us to, and however we find that place, because I find it like washing dishes sometimes, because I just, you know, that every morning at 6 a.m. I get up. That's not how my life is. I desire that, but I can't do that. So I'm doing the dishes. Oh, Jesus, I love you. Lord, anywhere we find it, Lord, help us to, that's the most important thing. This is all about our closeness with you. And I pray that for us today. Amen.
Thanks, Mom. Yeah, nice. Yeah, very good. And that has been resonating in our family, and I wonder how many of you have been going through that same thought process. This really is not about the rules, guys. It's about a relationship with Jesus. It's about that relationship changing who we are and changing who we're becoming. That's a big, big deal, because it's easy, you know, to think about the Pharisees of the Bible, right? Because they're those guys. The Pharisees are always those guys. But then when we open it and we analyze who the Pharisees are and what the Pharisees do, I'm a lot more uncomfortable with how close they are to me. I'm a lot more uncomfortable with how much I look like them from time to time. And the reality is that the relationship with Jesus is about a relationship. The rules cannot save you. All right? Well, then why? Is there whole books of the Bible and they're dry and boring and horrible? That they are. They are horrible. I mean, every once in a while I find something good, you know, but I don't need to know how the bull was halved and exactly what part was burnt before the other. I'm sure that all has significance, but at some point I'm just like, Lord, tell me something good. You know what I mean? Tell me something good about me. And then he doesn't, you know? He kind of exposes something else. But one of the important things in Psalm 51, verse 16, David is making an appeal to God. And Psalm 51 is a very interesting psalm because we must understand, all the psalms are interesting when you put into context where the author was, what he was thinking, what he was doing when he wrote the psalm, because it really affects us. Anybody ever been in a problem in their life and you needed God to help you? Simple enough, right? Maybe I'm having financial trouble. Maybe I'm having, relational trouble. Maybe I'm having, a problem. But God, I need you to come and help me. But I can't even ask him because I'm the reason for the problem. And then the guilt and the shame, right? Well, just ask God. You don't understand. I can't. I'm guilty. I'm the cause of the problem, and therefore I can't come to God. I don't know who you're talking to, but it's not God. Because God says, you know, David says over and over, my anxieties when they were great within me, Oh God, you saw me and you knew my thoughts from far off, and you knew what I needed before I even made my petition. And yet we are our own worst judge and jury, aren't we? The enemy loves to pile on that. The enemy loves to come to you and say, hey, by the way, I agree with everything you're thinking about you, and here's some other stuff, you know? He piles it on, and you're a real piece of work, aren't you? You have a real, you know, gall to even come to the Lord. And the nature of God resounding through the scripture says, I'm not anything like that. I'm not anything like you fear I am. I'm not anything like you think I am. Because in Psalm 51, David makes this astounding statement. He says, for you do not desire sacrifice, or else I would give it. You do not delight in burnt offering. He goes on to say, the sacrifices of the heart, contrite spirit and a broken heart. You have yet to deny that. You desire brokenness in me, not sacrifice. Yeah, big deal. That sounds, we all smile and nod. Sounds good. David sounds spiritual. Sounds good. He just cheated with Bathsheba when he wrote this, the chapter before. I don't know how long. But he's reconciling his sin before the Lord, and it was great. He was guilty of murder, guilty of high government crimes. He was guilty of not only just the lust of the flesh, but adultery by killing this woman's husband and then taking the wife. That's hardcore, by the way. It's against the law. I looked into it. It's even in Oregon law. All right. But he's coming to God with this. So why don't you look at it a little differently knowing that? Don't you look at it a little differently and say, David, honestly, seriously, you're going to approach God like that? And yet the Spirit of God comes to him and says, I don't desire sacrifice, or else I know you'd give it. I desire brokenness on the inside. Why was David God's man and Saul wasn't? Remember, Saul was God's man before he wasn't. We have to face that fact. Did God put Saul into leadership to set him up? You ever thought about that? Did God already know Saul's going to fail and I'm going to show him? I can probably find some places in Scripture where I can support that type of worldview, but I don't believe that's happening. He anoints Saul king. It says that when he anointed Saul king, what did Samuel tell him? You're going to walk away from here. You're going to come up to a group of weirdos that are prophesying, and you're going to be filled with the Spirit and prophesy with them for days. The Spirit of God came mighty on Saul a number of times. It's one of the earliest places in Scripture where we find that someone is filled with the Holy Spirit. This is before Jesus. So how is that the case? He brought Saul in. He didn't bring him in to set him up. But Saul made a choice that David didn't. He made a choice to seek his own way. He made a choice to follow the ways of man. David never did. Even when David was caught, he came clean. That may seem really overly simple, but that is the difference between David and Saul. So let's talk about holiness. Matthew 6, if you please. Because I have really good news for you this morning, and my mission this morning is to show you how much God loves you and to show you the way he made for you is incredible because it has nothing to do with your abilities and it has everything to do with his. Matthew 6, we'll start in verse 1. We'll read through a couple of verses here. He says, take heed that you do not do your charitable deeds before men to be seen by them. Otherwise, you have no reward from your Father in heaven. Therefore, when you do a charitable deed, do not sound a trumpet before you as the hypocrites do in the synagogues and in the streets, that they may have glory from men. Listen to this. Assuredly, I say to you, they have their reward. But when you do a charitable deed, do not let your left hand know what your right hand is doing, that your charitable deed may be in secret, and your Father who sees in secret will himself reward you openly. A lot going on right there. Think about what he's saying. First of all, you almost walk away from it. If you've been in church for any length of time, you walk away with the scathing rebuke from the Lord against charitable deeds. Right? it's not in there, actually. He doesn't say there's anything wrong with the charitable deeds. He just says, don't be like them who do it in the open. Why? They have their reward. They just got seen for doing their charitable work, and they already have their reward. There's nothing left for them. I think what God is saying there is, I am a rewarder of those who diligently seek me. But when you circumvent my process, there's no more reward because you've given it to yourself. You're the prodigal son. You have taken your inheritance on your own and haven't waited for the blessing of the Father. All right? Interesting statement at the end. He says, your charitable deed may be in secret, and your Father who sees in secret will himself reward you in secret. No, it says reward you openly. Right? God, we all know those people that are too spiritually minded, they're no earthly good. I love that phrase. You ever hear, you know, those people, they're so spiritual that they're just no good to anybody, and they're like, yeah, they're insufferable people, you know. Their idea of holiness, when we talk about the Christian life, right, we're talking about holiness and living a holy life. And if you grew up in a Christian home particularly, there is that idea, isn't there? There's a whole bunch of stuff you can't do because it ain't holy. Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles were one of those things in my house. When that cartoon was on, couldn't watch that. It was not holy, all right? And my mother adequately saw no, so I watched it at Grandpa and Grandma's house. So, and Aunt Jana's house. Anyway, hi. she didn't know. Aunt Jana was in the other room praying. It wasn't a big deal. Yeah. But we have this whole list of holy stuff, right? And we know those people that have those long lists, right? You know, in fairness, I think they're rarer today than they were when I was a kid. You know, those sort of fringe people, fringe families, they don't do nothing. You know what I mean? You can probably picture them as like Amish, I guess, that they're very so into the literary concept of holiness that it's like, to us, we'd have to rethink life entirely. You know what I mean? Because we can't just do that. But holiness is something a little bit different. And by a little bit, I mean a lot bit. So Matthew 6, verse 5, and when you pray, you shall not be like the hypocrites. Doesn't call them Pharisees there. He just says, don't be like hypocrites. For they love to pray standing in the synagogues and on the corners of the streets, that they may be seen by men. Assuredly, I say to you, again, they have their reward. But you, when you pray, this is from Jesus, it's in red, that's how we know. He says, when you pray, go into your room. Some translations say inner room. Some translations will be so bold as to say secret place. And when you have shut your door, pray to your Father who is in the secret place. Significant. And your Father who sees in secret will again reward you openly. And when you pray, do not use vain repetitions as the heathen do, for they think that they will be heard for their many words. Therefore, do not be like them, for your Father knows the things you have need of before you ask him. In this manner, therefore, pray. And then it goes into the Lord's Prayer, which is a pretty good prayer. It's a good prayer, my Lord. You know what I mean? I know it's a good prayer. It's the Lord's Prayer. You know, there's no prayer greater. But and that's a whole study in itself. But there's some significant stuff about what God says here. This is Jesus talking about God, talking about the Father. I can't hear God. I don't know where God is. I feel, you know, you ever heard the term, the heavens are like brass. I mean, these are all things people experience, right? You're praying, you don't hear God, you don't know where he is. Guess what? God is not hiding. He is still where he has always been. Jesus, by his death on the cross, has opened a way for you and for me. God is not hiding. He is certainly alive and not dead, but he is not hiding. He says, your Father, who is in the secret place. He's in the secret place. God does not hold an anvil over your head waiting to drop it when you stop being holy. Instead, he invites you to secret place with him. He invites you and me. He says, I'm going to one up that. I'm going to spend some private time with you. Psalm 23 says, he prepares a table in the midst of my enemies. He takes care, right? He leads me beside still waters. He restores my soul. God isn't like a king who sent a conscript to come help you. God is like a king who sent himself. He has a lot of subjects, but he sent himself. My kids, I have four of them, each have about a quarter of me, if they're lucky. You and I are millions upon millions upon millions of souls, and we each have the whole thing in our Father. We each have access to the whole thing. He invites you into the secret place. In this world of all these changing events, you can't walk in the center. It's very comfortable to say, well, I go to church. Yeah, I have a cross on my necklace. I'm good to go, right? And so many people have lived that life, but the veneer is falling off in these times. We know that it's not what it used to be. We know that there's a decision to be made. Jesus himself, I love, there's so many quotations I could bring out, even from renowned atheists that talk about their presumption of God and the biggest deterrent to God. Even Gandhi himself said, right? I would love to believe in Jesus. It's just his followers I'm not sure about. It's what an unbelieving world simply finds unbelievable. Jonathan Edwards, the great, you know, 17th century preacher, had this great statement. He said, "Oh Lord, my prayer is that you would light my life on fire so others could watch me burn." Whoa! That's intense, but that's secret place living. I don't think Jonathan Edwards watched Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles, but I don't think it would have mattered. I don't think that was the dividing line between him and righteous living, between him and holiness, and it's not the dividing line for you and I either. It's not the TV you watch. It's not the words you say. Now, hear me out. I'm going to finish that statement. It's not what we decide is right and wrong. It's the heart. David says over and over, God, you see the heart. Man looks at the exterior. We can only see what we can see with our eyes. But God, you see the heart. You know the heart. God knows what he's doing. He prepares Moses in the desert to serve in the palace. He prepares Joseph in the palace to serve in the desert, right? He does all of these things. His ways are righteous. And guess what he uses? By the way, if you look like at Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, you ever sit and read about those lives, particularly Jacob, looking at, oh, these are the patriarchs of the faith. These are the holiest men that ever lived. And they were scoundrels. Like, they were used car salesmen, thief, liars. They were horrible. And yet they were holy. Why? How? It's not a set of rules. It's about relationship with God. So what does holiness mean? Well, where are the rules? The Pharisees asked Jesus that. Jesus says, if you love me, you'll obey my commandments. I've shared this before. If you love me, you'll obey my commandments. So the Pharisee heart responds, well, what are the commandments? Let's get to it. I've already kept all the law. He didn't hear me. If you love me, you'll obey my commandments. What does that mean? If you love me, you're going to be transformed into a person out of which the acts of the law naturally flow. Do you think that more murders don't happen in our state just because it's on the books, it's against the law? Maybe. But the reality is, we don't have to go. I think I've shared this illustration before. It occurred to me, we don't have to go door to door reminding everyone, hey, by the way, robbery, you know, beating someone up and taking their money, against the law, don't do it. Because the majority of people are already people out of which the act of that law naturally flows. It's not because they know it's ORS. What is it, Gary? 166. Anyway, they don't know just because it's a statute. Don't matter. That happens to be against the law. But guess how many people that committed robbery knew it was against the law? All of them. All of them. Right? We've all sinned. We've all fallen short. So what's holiness? Love this great illustration. There's many brushes in my house, right? I have a brush out in the garage, and I can use it for washing the car. I can use it for washing the kids' bikes. I use it for washing off the lawn furniture. I use it for all of that stuff. And there's one brush I have, and it has all of these uses. Heck, if the neighbor wanted it, here, yeah, you can borrow it too. I don't care what you want to do with it. It's a utility brush. Then you come inside my house, and inside of a drawer is another brush. It's a hairbrush. And my family's close enough. We all use the brush. Pretty much only my family. You can't use my brush. You know what I mean? Only my family can use my brush. That's its purpose. And then I have a toothbrush. My toothbrush serves only one purpose. brushing my teeth. Right? You cannot borrow it. In fact, Jack, my son, thinks he can use my toothbrush. And he is sorely mistaken. I have told him, you may not use my toothbrush, and stop. And I got a new one, because that grosses me out big time. Here, now, fine, you have 8 toothbrushes. He keeps stealing my... Anyway, that's beside the point. My toothbrush is holy unto me. Make sense? It has one use, and it's for me. I don't mean to be selfish, but I'll buy you a toothbrush for you, but I get one, and it's for me. You may not use it. All right? I was going to share how I discovered my toothbrush was used one time, but I won't. It's not important. My kids are an adventure. Anyway, Dad, I cleaned that. Okay. It violated me. And the reason is because my toothbrush is holy unto me. Okay? Makes sense? Stupid euphemism, but does it make sense? You and I, and this will preach, right? You and I are God's toothbrushes. Maybe that doesn't preach real good, but you get what I'm saying? He has nice teeth, don't worry. Great, and great breath. You get what I'm saying? You have a singular purpose, and more importantly, your purpose is for a singular being, and that is God himself. He has crafted you and fashioned you for a purpose. Your purpose is not to fulfill the lusts of the flesh. Your purpose is not to pursue yourself. Your purpose is not to pursue another. Your purpose is not to do what the world wants you to do. Your purpose is not to get a college degree. Go for it. But that is not your purpose. Your purpose is not to get a good high-paying job. That is not your purpose. Your purpose is not just to raise kids or to be a good husband. All of those things are good. But your singular purpose is holiness. You are holy unto the Lord. Once you said yes to Jesus, he said, your life is about to get a whole lot harder and a whole lot better. Hang on, buckle your seatbelt. I make good on my promises. You are holy unto the Lord. A toothbrush. You've got one purpose, and your purpose in fulfillment is for one person, and that is God. Stop taking on guilt and shame over how you fall short. Stop taking on guilt and shame every time, oh, I did it again. And my self-talk starts building an identity that says, I'll never get this. I'll never be holy. I'll never. You need to talk about even a scripture that says, be holy as I am holy.
Right.
You know, I'll wait for that sermon. Right, I'll wait for that sermon so someone can explain exactly what that means, because I know it don't mean that. Be holy as I'm holy. Right on, Jesus. You know what I mean? And meanwhile, I live the life I live. You know? And it looks nothing like his. Until I'm filled with love. I'm filled with relationship. And the relationship then determines the rules. So you mean it's okay to commit all these sins? Stop asking that question. And be in love with Jesus and watch what happens to your desires. They're transformed. All of a sudden, you're not looking in the Bible wondering whether adultery is okay. It would never occur because it would be a violation of the love that has filled me. It would be a violation of my task as God's toothbrush. I keep using the silly euphemism, but I want you to understand. It would be silly to take the same toothbrush, unless it was decommissioned for rifle cleaning or something like that, and use it for any other task. Because you have one task, and specifically for one person. Be holy as I am holy. He is saying, this isn't an impossible task. Jesus showed us the way. Can we be perfect like he is perfect? Let me ask this question. Can we be sold out like he was sold out? Can you be filled with the Spirit like he was filled with the Spirit? The answer is yes. Plan B will hurt you. Having your foot in the door will cause you to never fully live in the reality of the kingdom. You know that? How many people have been at a point in their life? Maybe it was when they were younger. Maybe they haven't been there yet. But the foot's in the door. God, I love you. I love you mostly. Or my life, I believe in God and I like the faith and I like how it makes me feel. And so I'm adding that to my life. You know, I'm a police officer and a Christian. But my life, in reality, I am a person infatuated with Jesus Christ, and I happen to be employed as a deputy sheriff. It changes my life in a scary way. I am in the midst of changes that I have never contemplated in my life before because I believe in the kingdom now. What he's inviting you to is not holiness sometime when you die and all of a sudden you're sinless because you can't move. He's inviting you to holiness now. Oh, but I watched the Ninja Turtles, you know? I'm using that silly, but for everyone, they have those things, don't they? Guys, how many of you can't control your eyes, can't control your thoughts? Those lust, that lust of the eyes comes in. It is a battle. But if there were no battle, there is no achievement. Did it ever occur to you that love isn't love without a choice? We can't love God when he's the only game in town. You pay bills, don't you? Talk to your electric companies. How many options do you have? None. PGE told you, right? Or wherever you live, there's something, right? It's a monopoly. There are no other game in town. So even complaining about it's useless. It just is what it is. God says, I'm not going to be the only game in town. I'm not going to be the only option for you to choose. By the way, he's the best. But I'm not going to be the only game in town. Because I have destined for you to accomplish and achieve something. I am a rewarder of those who diligently seek me. So when you pray, you go into the secret place where your Father is, and he who sees in secret will reward you openly. Say, well, I'm always at the bottom of the barrel, but that's the way God needs. You know, it's just secret. It's in the secret. No, no, he says, I'm going to reward you openly. He gets his people where he needs them to be. His purpose for all of us isn't fame. It isn't, you know, some idea of puffed up self-importance or anything like that. But he gets his people where he needs them to be. Your promotion at work, your promotion in life is not up to your bosses. Well, I can read you scriptures if you want to argue about it. I'm telling you, and yes, ultimately, I know there's a reality there. There's decision makers and their influence is certain. But it's God himself that has his hand on your life. He gets his people where he wants them to be. Amen. God does not desire in you and me sacrifice. Right? My son's playing soccer, kicking a ball around a field. And I don't know if you've hung around Jude. Jude's like he can start running and then never stop. He's at that phase in his life where he weighs like 18 pounds. And, you know, he's all legs. So just, phew, you know, and just makes me tired watching him. You know what I mean? Like, oh, goodness. But Jude loves this thing because he got something from his mom. Mom with sports or games is like a junkyard dog. Maybe that's too harsh, but play a game with her. It's pretty competitive, all right? She will sacrifice. Now, my wife's funny because my wife could be a gym rat. Like, I could buy her a pass to, like, the coolest gym, and I wouldn't see her again for a while. She likes that. You could buy me the pass to the nicest gym there is, and I might go look at it. All right? Online. Okay? I have no interest in working out. I have no interest in exercise. I'll do it begrudgingly from time to time, but I don't care for it. Jennifer, though, will go and she will lose interest in about 2 days unless there are other women there. I'm going to cover my wife, but this is something I actually think is kind of cool, so here you go. She signed us up for CrossFit, which is Latin for you can't do this. And it just is what it is. And it's a co-ed thing. They just have a class and all the weight is relative to what you can do. But the whole goal is go, and then puke, and then you're done. And it's as long as you can take to do that. But I always wind up, you know, they're like, okay, the prescribed weight, they have a prescribed weight for that event is 75 pounds. So I say, great. So I put 75 pounds on my bar, and then I, whoa, nope, You know, that's heavy. Hello. So I'll take some weight off. Don't want to tax it too hard. I have a job. I can't, you know, be unable to move at work. You know, this is rationale. Anyway, so I do something nice to me. And then there's always a girl next to me. It's always a girl. And she's lifting double what I'm doing. And I'm like, I'm going to move, you know. And so I move. I always find myself in the corner. Get the guys. I get the guys going, yeah, you know what I'm saying? I'm a cop. You know what I'm saying? You know, really? I actually don't remember that. I'm only losing 35 pounds, you know. And so I find my spot. Jennifer. She's looking around. Where's Lisa at? Where's Lisa? Because Lisa's the strongest, you know. Making up names, I don't know. She's the strongest. Oh, where's she at? Oh, what's she doing, 85? 88 pounds, please. That's my girl right there, you know, and she's looking at me. All of a sudden, she's, oh, you want to drink water, honey? Okay, we're going to go in 20 seconds. And I can't, you know, my wife all of a sudden, I'm like, honey, I'm kind of thirsty. Get over your spot, you know, and I'm over because I can't hang around her. And she goes, right? She's willing to put it on the line. And guess what? When we're done with that, she's going back later. You know what I mean? Because Chelsea might be at that one. You know what I mean? And that's it. But my wife admittedly needs something to compare. And she is not vain as a person. If you know her, she is not vain. She needs the motivation of knowing she's achieving something. She's accomplishing something. And when she finds a goal, she doesn't let go of it, which is why this family works, by the way. It's how it gets us through, because even in the silly things, it is what works in my wife is that she finds a goal and finds a purpose and she goes for it and won't let go. The greatest purpose I have ever seen her undertake is her love for God. But in her love for God, it's different than her love for working out because she doesn't need somebody else. She's always a wreck about God, and I love that. My point is that Jude got a little bit of this. And so when he plays soccer, you know, gosh, soccer. I love my son. I don't love soccer. Okay. It's use your feet. I'm like, you just don't use these two hands. You just don't use them. That can't be, you know, something God intended. You know what I'm saying? He made me to have sports that use everything, you know? Anyway, it does turn out to be quite a contact sport, by the way. And because it's like an amoeba of children following a ball, you know? It used to be more so when they were younger. They have some strategy now. But by and large, they're still sort of convinced, I can run faster than anyone on the field. And everyone has this singular, you know, persuasion. I am the fastest person on the field, and therefore, I will chase down the ball, and I will kick it through the goal. And they all are, it's like, almost like a, you know, just a dust cloud, and there's cleats and feet and shoelaces coming out of the dust cloud. We're watching a ball pops out, and but it's a contact sport. And so, you know, you kind of watch your kids right in the beginning. I remember Daphne played soccer, and it was a little different, you know, back then. God bless her. And she was so cute. She didn't get to the pig pen soccer where it's just, you know, crazy. Not that I recall. Anyway. But Jude will go there and what you kind of watch your kid. Well, how is he going to respond? Right? When he gets hit and knocked down and he's in, you know, uh-oh. Well, is he going to get back up and be okay? Jude has this thing that has developed that's a little scary. And I don't know how to train it, but it's scary because he'll run to the ball. Boom! Someone will, you know, blow him up and he'll follow. Cause somebody's got to win that collision. You know, there's always one. You know, I'm from Gaston. You know what I mean? And this is my last year playing soccer, right? It's always his last year playing soccer. Anyway, a lot of video games. But he'll go flying. And so I'm like, oh, oh, he hit the deck. What's going to happen? And Jude comes up with this like, you know, and there's a rage that comes, and I'm like, oh my God. Oh, baby boy, you know, like, because he's my son, and he looks just like me. He's like me, but no, he ain't like me, you know, because I don't do that. And then I remember, oh, it's like he's lifting weights with Lisa, right? There's all of a sudden the situation is taking on a new gravitas, you know what I mean? He has a new singular purpose. He's not even really interested in scoring a goal as much as he is in popping the ball because he's kicked it so hard, you know what I mean? It's sort of this aggression that comes out, and he got that from mom, right? And so it's funny because, you know, the family is like, well, he's like me in every other way, but that one, you know. Well, you and I need to look like our father. Amen. We need to look like our parents. And God, by the way, I have this strange conviction. God is neither male nor female. If he created both of us, there are facets of us in him. By the way, he doesn't get hung up on that stuff. And so we need to look like mom and dad, amen? You follow me on that? We need to look like our Heavenly Father. He's intended for you to do great things. He's intended for you to respond and react in his way. And it's about training. What we do makes a difference. If you get a new Bible reading plan and wake up tomorrow and say, I've got to commit to this Bible reading plan, it will get old faster than you can blink. Okay, you get a new pair of running shoes, you're going to go for one run. One, if you're like me. All right? And you intended for 12 miles, and you went around the block, and you say, you know, there's a lot of road construction. And, you know, the resistance will meet you at every point. Because anything you do to better yourself physically, mentally, spiritually, resistance is going to meet you. But I'm suggesting to you that even that same Bible reading plan, and the Bible is the Word of God, it is life to us. But if you do that as a discipline because you should, it will be old, it will be stale, and it will be absolutely impotent in your life. But if you say, I just love you, Lord, and I'm going to commit to this because what I'm trying to do is look like you. The disciplines I'm putting in my life aren't for the rules, they're for the relationship. It's one big yes, not 100,000 no's. I married my wife 2001, September 16th, and I gave one big yes. I don't go into every room and scope out every woman. No, 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 no. Whew. Okay, next room. I said one big yes. That's mine. That's my girl. That's it. I'm done. Holiness is like that. Jesus invites us. Are you ready for one big yes? You say yes to Jesus, don't worry about the other stuff. But we live the opposite, don't we? We go around saying, no, 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 borderline, but probably no, 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 right? All the stuff we're just guilty about. We just feel guilty about it. Maybe I watch too much football, something innocuous, something I don't care about. No, 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 oh, no, I'm guilty anyway because of the thing I said yes to. Hey, Jesus is one big yes. Holiness is a big yes. I'm willing to be set apart. I'm willing to have a singular purpose, and I'm willing to be set apart for a singular being, and that is God. I do that. Don't worry about the no's. They're going to come in time. You will transform over time. Your desires will change. By the way, temptation isn't going to go away, not until you're in the grave. I kind of recently came upon that realization. Temptation doesn't just leave. It's not gone. Well, you've been serving the Lord, and yeah, you know, I led worship and preached. You know how holy I am? That don't mean anything. It doesn't mean anything. Holiness is about a big yes to him. Because I go in secret to my Father who sees in secret, and that's when he rewards me openly. He doesn't reward me openly for this. He doesn't reward me openly because I'm doing something spiritual. It doesn't work like that. It's about a big yes. And I said a big yes to Jesus. And I know you did too. So stop living defeated. Stop believing the lies that you're not making it. You're not getting there. You're not doing it. Why does God send people to hell? God doesn't send anyone to hell. He created hell for angels, for fallen angels, not for you. And Jesus said, you're going to get into hell over my dead body. You're going to have to step over me to get there. You're going to have to run around me to get there. Don't you see? I didn't do this for 10% of your money. I didn't do this so you'd tithe to me some of your paycheck. God wasn't up there saying, oh, I love them so much. I love my people so much. I'm giving them 10%. I'm giving them 10% of what I got. He said, I love them so much. I'm selling out. I'm giving them everything I have. And so when Jesus asks in return for everything we have, he doesn't want 10% of your money. He wants 100% of your money. He doesn't want 10% of your heart. He wants 100% of your heart. Do you think God's interested in nickels and dimes? God is interested in the heart. And will you spend it all on him? Hear what I'm saying, not what I'm not, all right? He's put you in charge of your life to steward your finances and to steward your children, to steward the resources he puts into your life. But he wants the whole thing. Don't you get it? It doesn't work differently. It doesn't work with plan B. It doesn't work with the foot in the door. It only works when we've said one big yes and stop saying 100,000 no's. Amen.